Today's video is sponsored by Audible. Audiobooks are a huge part of my studio practice. You've heard me rave before about different titles I've listened to while painting, including The Subtle Art of Not Giving a Fuh, a title available through Audible. Audible subscriptions give you monthly credit toward audiobooks, discount on additional titles, and 2 free monthly Audible Originals. Audible Originals are exclusive audio titles created by storytellers in theater, journalism, literature. This month I'm excited about Stanley Tucci's multi-voice cast adaptation on the best-selling novel The Man on the Mountaintop. The story of a 72-year-old man who lives in Hermitage atop a mountain where pilgrims come by the thousands seeking wisdom. To get your first audiobook free, try Audible for 30 days by visiting audible.com/RobinSealark, or for U.S. listeners, texting RobinSealark to 500-500. Again, that's audible.com/RobinSealark or texting RobinSealark to 500-500. Link in description.
Oh, Chante, I'm Mademoiselle. Can I just say it is so nice to make your acquaintance?
Oh, thank you.
They say an artist is only as good as their tools, so today we're going to put that to the test. Today we're going to be turning these potatoes into paintbrushes, and I'm going to make an entire painting using only potatoes. If you're not already subscribed, please do so, and if you'd like to check out any of my social media accounts, you can do so at RobinSealark across Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Patreon, all the things. I hope you guys enjoy this, and I will see you after this video. Welcome to the voiceover. Let us begin with our potato tool making. I had an assemblage of a number of tools to whittle these potatoes. See, I had very high hopes initially. I brought out my paintbrushes, I thought about different widths and shapes, things we might do to make our potatoes more like unto a paintbrush. Now, I'm sorry to say I don't have the original audio from this where I was directly reacting to and explaining what I was doing, but you'll have to settle with me, the aftermath Robin. I decided to make a series of chunks to begin with because that's seems like the easiest to start whittling wise. I'm not much of a whittler. I don't have experience whittling tools from potatoes or any other material, but you gotta chunk it down just so you can get it into somewhat of a shape that's similar to a tool you might paint or write with. As I started off though, I started to realize that you having these flat edges with very little whittling might actually be the way to go. See, I created a shape that was much smaller and more pointed, and all it did was give me a really wiggly tip that didn't have enough firmness and didn't feel stable. So I chunked down a few more pieces of potato. I decided to make a sort of wide brush head with just the sides of these and have some varying degrees of widths, and then also use a pointed edge. Again, I tried to make more tools in interesting shapes, but the flimsiness of the potato when you got to a certain size, it's not like a paintbrush where you have a firm handle grasp, but then you have some soft bristles. It's just like what would you call it? It's like a squeegee? I gotta look up squeegee. But it's kind of like a paint scraper or a rubber spatula. It's more like you scrape the paint along with it. Yeah, so here's my final tools. They're basically just misshapen french fries that aren't fried. To give myself some assemblage of a sanity and structure to this, I knew it was gonna be a challenge already to work with potatoes, so I decided to tape off my edges as I like to do, and we're gonna start with doing an underdrawing as well. I decided to go with some easy-ish subject matter, something that I'm very accustomed to at this point, which is of course a landscape, something I've been working on for years now. And I did a field. There's not a lot going on visually, it's pretty simplistic, but it does have some detail work to give you suggestions of forms so that as I'm going along it's not gonna look too blobby. I want to have some amount of detail, but you know, like not too much. I want to have some amount of detail so it's a recognizable image if it ends up being too hard for me, but also not overweigh my skill level. Something unexpected about this was how hard the paint mixing portion is. At a certain point, I'll cut off the palette and you won't see me doing the mixing portion. We'll just focus on the painting. But this itself was an unexpected challenge, so I figured I would include it. See, here's where I first started running into trouble, aka when I first started using the potatoes. I had this this first section mixed up pretty well, so that wasn't a problem, but I realized very quickly how hard it is to actually layer on the paint, because the potato acts more or less just like a scraper to flatten the paint along the page. I wish I knew better terminology for potato painting, but this is the best I've got, okay? So now you can see, though, where I start having problems with mixing. If you do not mix really well when you put the paint onto there, then you end up getting these scrubby lines of unmixed colors, and instead of having a well-integrated paint, I just have smears of red. So I had to remix this and mix up my methodology a little bit. I did swirling motions to kind of mix the existing paint that was on the page. And this was one of the more frustrating components of painting with a potato, is actually getting paint to cover your surface and to get a fair coating. Next, I decided to put in some detail work to the top of my mountain and try out using one of my pointed potato slices. Again, so frustrating. You know what's surprising about these potatoes too is they're wet and they stay pretty wet throughout the process. I mean, this painting didn't take me too long to make, a couple hours maybe. I used it, I scraped the paint along. It was kind of painstaking. It's not like with a paintbrush where the paint carries well. You have to kind of maneuver what part of the potato that you're painting with and get it so that the paint you've already spread on, you move over your potato, and then if you want to really understand the struggle, you can try it for yourself, okay? I know I'm not doing a great job explaining, but like how, you know, potato brushes don't really have a set coordinates of how they're structured or function. Oh my gosh. Okay, more detail work. I spent a fair amount of time just trying to cover that base, like I was saying. I didn't want it to look like there was any paper showing through. I wanted to get a good set of greens down and some kind of levels to give structure to the hills. And then I figured I could go in with some more minute detail work and give it a little bit more structure. This is part of why I chose this imagery. It's very easy to throw in little dabs of color and make those be trees in the distance or brush in the distance. So instantaneously you have a little bit of visual information for the viewer, contextualization, something to give you a better idea of what you're making. I think I could challenge myself a little bit harder if I were to do this a second time, but for a first time using a potato, I think it actually ended up coming out pretty good despite the level of frustration I felt. I tried to pump up my colors a little bit because I realized it was kind of a boring image, so as I went along this, I made a little bit more surreal of coloring, added extra yellow, popped in some pink to the sky, which in the reference was completely a dull gray. And here, another section of really difficult painting. I was trying to make this brushwork in the front to give you a little bit more detailing. I tried using a number of methods. You can see me here using the point of one of the potatoes, and it was really difficult to get something very thin. So a lot of times what I ended up doing is I would paint with part of the potato, and then I would wipe away the sides of it to make more clean lines and to thin out those markings. So I had to work relatively fast to make sure the paint stayed wet, and then I could just wipe away. Apply paint, wipe away, apply paint, wipe away. The next thing I tried to do was stamping. So instead of using the corner of the potato, I used the edge and I coated that with paint, and then I would just stamp it down onto the paper and use a clean part of the potato to wipe away any excess and thin out these grass blades. This is actually a methodology I use when painting hair in portraiture sometimes. If I want to get flyaways on the outside of the head, I'll paint on the hair and then I'll paint back around the edges of the hair to make individual strands be extremely thin. So pro tip from a potato painter. You can kind of see there what I meant about applying paint to the edge and then stamping it down. It didn't always go smoothly. Stamping it down, the potato had kind of an internal structure, which while it is dense, cutting an edge on a potato is still not perfectly flat. There's some divots. I tried using this next for a weird methodology. I figured I'd make a very thin slice and try to do lines, but the problem is that paint doesn't transfer super well from a potato, so I pretty quickly abandoned that and went back to using the point
of my potato for adding in detail work. I did this kind of in layers or stages. I'd put in some initial detailing and then I had to add in more color because I didn't feel like it was vibrant enough, which covered up some of my detailing. So added more brush work in the distance. And it really is in those tiny details that the painting gets made because it needs more structure in order to look like a finished product in the end. And those details ended up being my final slot. I added in a little bit more brush, I added in more grass blades, and then I decided to take off our tape layer using a hairdryer to break the adhesiveness and not rip the paper as always. But before we do the final reveal, before I show you what it looked like all uncoated and glazed, let's take a look back. Our whittling tools, our paint brushes, our potatoes. Given the limitations of working with potato slices, and given the level of frustration I had throughout this entire process, I have to say I was really happy with the end result, and I think I have my prep work to thank for that. Taping, drawing, and having clean edges really helped. And no, final reviews, I don't think I would ever suggest to use a potato over a paintbrush. Go to the freaking craft store, use a 50% off coupon, and throw the potatoes in a salad or something instead.
How'd I do? I haven't seen yet. I'm recording this before I made it. Was it good? Was it bad? I'm sure it's great. If you'd like to, make sure you're subscribed to this channel. Check out my social media links at Robin Sealark. And you can check out any of my paintings at robinsealark.com. You have a nice day there, folks. Bye.